Good evening. It's Tuesday, February 15th. Russian President Putin says he's ready for talks with the U.S. and NATO on limits for missile deployments and military transparency as Russia announces it's pulling back some troops from exercises that have raised fears of a potential invasion of Ukraine. But the West is skeptical and remarks at the White House. President Biden, while promising the U.S. would continue to give diplomacy every chance, insists the U.S. and its allies will not sacrifice basic principles respecting Ukraine's sovereignty. Families of the victims of the Sandy Hook Elementary shooting massacre reach a $73 million settlement with gun manufacturer Remington, who built the AR-15 used to kill 20 first graders and three teachers in 2012. A state legislative effort to give California tools to combat misinformation and disinformation about COVID-19 and vaccines. And San Francisco's police chief says he's investigating claims by the district attorney that DNA collected from rape victims is being used to help identify them as possible crime suspects. From Pacifica Radio, KPFA in Berkeley, KPFK in Los Angeles, this is the Evening News. I'm Mark Maracle. Russian President Vladimir Putin said today that he welcomed a security dialogue with the West, and his military reported pulling back some of its troops near Ukraine. Putin met with German Chancellor Olaf Scholz in Moscow.
With regard to the Russian desire for legal security guarantees with the US and NATO, we talked about the main demands of Russia, the non-extension eastwards of NATO, the non-deployment of missiles on Russian frontiers.
Speaking after his meeting with Scholz, Putin said the West had agreed to discuss a ban on missile deployment to Europe, restrictions on military drills, and other confidence-building measures, issues that Moscow put on the table years ago. He said Russia is open to discuss some of those elements, but said it would do so only in combination with the main issues that are of primary importance to Russia's national interest.
Do we want war or not? Of course we don't, and it's for that reason that we have submitted a proposal as to a negotiation process as a result of which there should be a guarantee for security for everybody, including our country. Unfortunately, we have already said this, we have not yet received any kind of substantive answer to this submission.
Russia said that some of its armed forces participating in military exercises will begin returning to their bases. The announcement came from the country's foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov. His remarks appeared on Al Jazeera.
As far as the exercises which are being carried out in our own territory, they were mounted as planned and are being disbanded at the end of the exercises. There's absolutely nothing strange about that, and that applies also to the joint exercises with Belarus. All of it was done according to a pre-planned timetable and has nothing to do with the way the media outlets are portraying the situation.
But NATO and Western governments said they had seen no signs of de-escalation yet, despite the Russian Defense Ministry's announcement that it's pulling back forces from the maneuvers. Giles Gibson reports from London.
Russia's Defense Ministry says it's pulling some of its troops back from its border with Ukraine amid concerns over a potential invasion. But UK Foreign Secretary Liz Truss says Western allies need to see a full-scale drawdown of Russian forces. She was responding to comments by Russian officials on Tuesday, saying some units have, quote, completed their missions and are moving back from the border.
We've seen 100,000 troops stationed around the border. Separately, the Russians have claimed that they have no plans for an invasion, but we will need to see a full-scale removal of troops to show that is true.
Russia's defense ministry has released video footage that it says shows tanks leaving border areas, but it's unclear how many troops are on the move. Germany's Chancellor Olaf Scholz is in Moscow for talks with Russian President Vladimir Putin. From Feature Story News in London, I'm Giles Gibson.
At the White House, President Joe Biden said the U.S. had not verified Russia's claim of a drawdown and declared that invasion was still a distinct possibility. In a brief address to the country, Biden promised that the U.S. would continue to give diplomacy every chance to prevent a Russian invasion.
The United States and NATO are not a threat to Russia. Ukraine is not threatening Russia. Neither the U.S. nor NATO have missiles in Ukraine. We do not have plans to put them there as well. We're not targeting the people of Russia. We do not seek to destabilize Russia. To the citizens of Russia, you are not our enemy. And I do not believe you want a bloody, destructive war against Ukraine, a country and a people with whom you share such deep ties of family, history, and culture. 77 years ago, our people fought and sacrificed side by side to end the worst war in history. World War II was a war of necessity. But if Russia attacks Ukraine, it would be a war of choice, or a war without cause or reason. I say these things not to provoke.
But clearly Biden was suspicious of Russia's intentions.
If Russia does invade in the days and weeks ahead, the human cost for Ukraine will be immense. And the strategic cost for Russia will also be immense. If Russia attacks Ukraine, it'll be met with overwhelming international condemnation. The world will not forget that Russia chose needless death and destruction. Invading Ukraine will prove to be a self-inflicted wound. The United States and our allies and partners will respond decisively. The West is united and galvanized.
The U.S. and NATO, which continue to warn that Russia could invade at any time, have sent troops and military supplies to shore up alliance members in Eastern Europe. Russia has denied having such plans. It wants the West to keep Ukraine and other ex-Soviet nations out of the NATO alliance, halt weapons deployments near Russia's borders, and roll back forces from Eastern Europe. The U.S. and its allies have roundly rejected those demands, but have offered to engage in talks with Russia on ways to bolster security in Europe. But Biden insisted the U.S. and its allies would not sacrifice what he called basic principles respecting Ukraine's sovereignty.
But let there be no doubt. If Russia commits this breach by invading Ukraine, responsible nations around the world will not hesitate to respond. We do not stand for freedom. Where it is at risk today will surely pay a steeper price tomorrow.
Biden took no questions after his address, which lasted less than 10 minutes. Sources told CNN News that elements of the speech had been prepared over the past few days, so perhaps Biden's remarks were not a direct response to Putin's comments earlier today. Asked if there could be a war in Europe, Putin said Russia doesn't want it, but that Ukraine's bid to join NATO posed a major security threat to his country. He said he would rely on negotiations in his efforts to eliminate any chance that Ukraine could one day join NATO. At the same time, he did not commit to a full pullback of troops in the area, saying Russia's next moves in the standoff will depend on how the situation evolves. At United Nations headquarters in New York, Secretary General Antonio Guterres said he was deeply worried by the heightened tensions and increased speculation about a potential military conflict in Europe.
The time is now to defuse tensions and de-escalate actions on the ground. There is no place for incendiary rhetoric. Public statements should aim to reduce tensions, not inflame them.
UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres. Meanwhile, Russian lawmakers today urged Putin to recognize rebel-held areas in eastern Ukraine as independent states. The State Duma, Russia's lower house, voted to submit an appeal to Putin to that effect. Putin said the request reflects the Russian public's sympathy for the suffering of people trapped in the conflict in eastern Ukraine that's killed over 14,000 people since 2014. He noted, however, that Russia continues to believe a 2015 peace deal brokered by France and Germany should serve as the main vehicle for a settlement of the separatist conflict. Putin's statement signaled that he wasn't inclined to back the parliament's proposal that would effectively invalidate the 2015 agreement, which had asked the Ukrainian government to offer broad-based self-rule to the separatist territories. The implementation of the so-called Minsk Accords has been stalled. The families of nine victims of the Sandy Hook Elementary School massacre have agreed to a $73 million settlement of a lawsuit against the maker of the rifle used to kill 20 first graders and six educators nearly 10 years ago. The families and a survivor of the shooting sued Remington over how it marketed the AR-15-style rifle used in the shooting. It alleged the company targeted younger, at-risk males in its advertising. David Wheeler is the father of one of the victims, six-year-old Benjamin Wheeler. He said the settlement should send a message to the weapons manufacturers, the banks that finance them, and their insurance companies, that there will be a steep price for irresponsible behavior.
One of the reasons Ben's not here is because some people made a decision driven by an increased desire for profits and a fear of a shrinking market share to focus their advertising on young men, to sell them their product. The most intentionally lethal consumer product our species has ever devised. They behaved irresponsibly to make more money, and their corporate partners turned the other cheek.
Remington had said the lawsuit should have been dismissed because of a federal law that gives broad immunity to the gun industry, but the Connecticut Supreme Court ruled Remington could be sued under state law over how it marketed the rifle. The gun maker appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court, which declined to hear the case. Adam Lanza, the 20-year-old Sandy Hook shooter, used the rifle made by Remington and legally owned by his mother to kill the children and the educators on December 14, 2012, after having killed his mother at their Newtown home. He then used a handgun to kill himself as police arrived. He had severe and deteriorating mental health problems. A new coalition is urging the legislature in the state of Michigan to tackle the epidemic of gun violence in the country, or else it will take the issue to the voters. Lily Volke reports.
Michigan ranks 21st for overall gun homicides, though that number is far greater when race is factored in. The state ranks 9th for gun homicides of black residents. Despite polls showing what's known as common sense gun legislation is popular, the legislature has not advanced such measures as red flag laws and safe gun storage laws. Mia Reed founded the Charles W. Reed Community Help Center in Detroit, named after her son, who was killed by gun violence in 2011. She says there's no time to waste.
There are lots of other great ideas that can also reduce gun violence too, like increased mental health funding, returning citizen reentry programs, violence intervention, and so much more. And we support all of these.
The coalition called End Gun Violence Michigan says if the legislature doesn't act in the next year, it will launch an initiative campaign to put gun control laws on the ballot. Yesterday, Valentine's Day marked 4 years since the Parkland school shooting in Florida. Kylie Myrand is a student at Oxford High School. She survived last November's shooting that took four lives, including one of her close friends, 16-year-old Tate Meyer.
Tate was going to be one of my forever friends with his goofy and dedicated personality, and our time together ended far too soon. This is why I'm talking to you all today, saying as a survivor and as a mourning 16-year-old girl, that something needs to change now.
A report from the Center for American Progress finds gun suicides also are on the rise in Michigan, especially among young people and veterans. And non-fatal gun injuries, as well as stolen firearms, continue to be issues in the state. This is Lily Bolke with Michigan News Connection.
And you're listening to the evening news on KPFA in Berkeley, KPFK in Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online, kpfa.org. Some Democratic state lawmakers want to give California some tools to combat misinformation and disinformation about COVID-19 and vaccines. They say such false information has led to low vaccination rates, avoidable hospitalizations and deaths, and even help prolong the pandemic. Christopher Martinez files this report.
False or misleading information has been a big obstacle in addressing the COVID-19 pandemic, especially as social media platforms have amplified misinformation and disinformation. Two Democratic state lawmakers want California to take action. Democratic Senator Richard Pan of Sacramento is chair of the Senate Health Committee.
I'm proud that yesterday I introduced Senate Bill 1018 to try to address the amplification of misinformation and disinformation on online platforms by requiring online platforms to publicly disclose how their algorithms work and to share data for research purposes. We want to ensure that the public knows how these algorithms and platforms are actually potentially pushing misinformation, disinformation in front of people.
The problem is not new. Last July, a reporter asked President Joe Biden about misinformation on platforms like Facebook.
They're killing people. I mean, it really, look, the only pandemic we have is among the unvaccinated. And they're killing people.
It's an issue that has drawn attention at the national level. Indeed, there's already a proposed bill in Congress called the Platform Transparency and Accountability Act. But its fate in Congress is unclear, especially given a narrowly divided partisan Senate with a filibuster rule. Pan, who is also a physician, says it should not be left to tech executives to decide how society responds to a pandemic.
Ideally, that we would have a national solution to this. However, we cannot wait. Ultimately, we shouldn't have to wait for whistleblowers like the Facebook whistleblower for us to understand how online platforms and social media have been negatively influencing our lives, including our ability to stop this pandemic that has not only killed so many people, but has also disabled so many people as well.
Another Democrat, Assemblymember Evan Lowe, has a related bill that takes aim at physicians who spread disinformation.
The spread of misinformation and disinformation specifically that the COVID-19 and vaccinations has caused continues to jeopardize our public health. And given the lives at stake, yesterday, a group of us legislators who care about the integrity of public trust, we introduced Assembly Bill 2098. This bill declares that disinformation and promotion of misinformation and disinformation of COVID-19 to the public as unprofessional conduct. Under this law, the California Medical Board will be given the tools necessary to bring discipline actions against a licensee.
The two lawmakers were joined by several advocates in their online news conference. Law professor Nathan Persily is director of Stanford Law School's Cyber Policy Center. He says the proposed legislation will help lead to better public policy.
And the bottom line here is that we cannot live in a world where Facebook and Google know everything about us and we know nothing about them. That we are in a sort of unique period in human history with respect to the information ecosystem. And these large information monopolies really have lost their right to secrecy. And through the through legislation like this and legislative efforts like that we're seeing at the federal level, the hope is, as Senator Pan mentioned, that we will gain the necessary information to enact sensible public policy.
Netta Ashtari is a third-year medical student at UCLA's School of Medicine. She says she's seen the consequences of disinformation in the intensive care unit, where she sees unvaccinated patients suffering with COVID.
Unfortunately, in the midst of our current public health emergency, a small number of reckless physicians have taken advantage of these trusted positions to spread misinformation for their own profit motives. These physicians are only a tiny fraction of the scientific community, but as we know from recent studies, social media algorithms amplify their voices 432 times the voices of pro-science physicians on their platforms.
13-year-old Ayan Moledina is a public health student ambassador with the group Protect Us. She lives in Austin, Texas, where she says teens are, in her words, drowned in misinformation. She says teens are especially vulnerable to misinformation on social media.
You know, my parents always told me to trust my doctor, but now it's a little different. There are doctors out there who work closely with anti-vaccine and anti-mask groups. They lend their credibility to these false narratives. How could a doctor possibly support this? We need to ensure that the doctor's office is a place where kids can be happy and healthy.
The advocates say they hope California's legislation serves as a model for other states and a prod for action at the federal level. Reporting for Pacifica Radio News, KPFA, I'm Christopher Martinez.
For the first time in 2 years for many people, the American workplace is transforming into something that resembles pre-pandemic days. Tyson's Foods said today it was ending mask requirements for its vaccinated workers in some facilities. Walmart and Amazon, the nation's number one and number two largest private employers, respectively, will no longer require fully vaccinated workers to don masks in stores or warehouses unless required under local or state laws. Tech companies like Microsoft and Facebook that had allowed employees to work fully remote are now setting mandatory dates to return to the office after a series of fits and starts. That's a stark reversal from just weeks ago when the Omicron variant of COVID-19 was peaking, prompting companies to double down on mask requirements and enforce daily health screenings while delaying return-to-office plans for remote workers. Reporter Mary Sherman has more.
Washington, D.C. is dropping its vaccine mandate for indoor venues today. As Mayor Muriel Bowser said, the city is in a much better place.
Since the height of Omicron wave entered the district in December, cases have dropped more than 90%.
D.C. will also drop its indoor mask requirements on March 1st, except in schools. On the Senate floor, Minority Leader Mitch McConnell blasted Democratic cities still requiring masks in schools.
The political left has put kids last. That's simply not acceptable. American families deserve normalcy.
Several Republican senators are speaking out against creating a federal no-fly list of unruly passengers, saying such restrictions should be left to the airlines, not the government. The FAA had nearly 6,000 unruly passenger reports in 2021, the majority related to mask mandates. I'm Mary Sherman for Pacifica Network and Public News Service.
And while Omicron seems to have peaked in the United States, the variant is currently overwhelming Hong Kong, where 10,000 people are currently awaiting admission to the hospital for treatment of COVID-19. Richard Kimba reports from Hong Kong.
The Hong Kong government says two new public housing estates, each with 3,000 flats and up to 10,000 more hotel rooms, will soon be used to isolate COVID-19 patients and their close contacts. Daily case numbers reached 2,071 on Monday, and early test data suggests there could be more than 4,500 cases confirmed by the end of Tuesday. Four elderly COVID-19 patients died on Monday. 10 more patients are in critical condition in hospital, including a three-year-old girl. Health authorities have bought 100 million rapid test kits and are distributing them to elderly care home staff in a bid to stop transmission chains among the city's older population. Richard Kimber in Hong Kong.
On Valentine's Day, California Governor Gavin Newsom got a 6-foot-tall Valentine, thanking him for putting Medi-Cal access for undocumented people into his latest budget proposal. Suzanne Potter reports.
Advocates brought a giant heart-shaped card to the Capitol covered in letters from dozens of Californians. Beatrice Hernandez with the California Immigrant Policy Center says right now hundreds of thousands of undocumented immigrants can only get emergency Medi-Cal coverage.
They can't just go to any regular visit to the doctor like you and I. They can only access care. Their lives are at risk, and it's an emergency.
Governor Gavin Newsom's proposal would open full-scale Medi-Cal coverage to income-eligible undocumented adults between ages 26 and 49. In recent years, the state has expanded eligibility to undocumented children, seniors, and young adults. Opponents of the program cite concerns about cost. The state legislative analyst's office says the proposal would cover another 700,000 people and cost the state $2.2 billion a year if it's implemented starting in 2024. Hernandez says it would make California the first state in the nation to offer health care for all.
It's putting California in the front and center and to show the rest of the nation that this is something that can be done. And this is what an equitable state can look like when people in power do the right thing.
Senator Maria Elena Durazo of Los Angeles and Assemblyman Joaquin Arambula of Fresno, both Democrats and supporters of the Health for All campaign, also signed the card. The California legislature has until June to approve a budget. For California News Service, I'm Suzanne Potter.
The House committee investigating the U.S. Capitol insurrection subpoenaed six more people today, including former Trump campaign members and state lawmakers, as it further expands its review into efforts to falsely declare Donald Trump the winner of the 2020 election in several swing states. The panel is seeking testimony and records from individuals who it says had knowledge of or participated in efforts to send false alternate electors from seven of the states President Joe Biden rightfully won. The individuals subpoenaed include Michael Roman and Gary Michael Brown, who served as directors for Trump's 2020 re-election campaign. The committee believes the two men reportedly promoted allegations of election fraud, as well as encouraged state lawmakers to appoint false slates of electors. The other four individuals are Pennsylvania State Senator Douglas Mastriano, Laura Cox, the former chair of the Michigan Republican Party, Arizona State Representative Mark Finchem, and Arizona Republican Party Chair Kelly Ward. 2 weeks ago, Ward and her husband filed a lawsuit against the House committee, seeking to block a subpoena of their phone records. They were presidential electors who would have voted for Trump in the Electoral College had he won Arizona. Both signed a document falsely claiming they were Arizona's true electors, despite Democrat Biden's victory in their state. Former Alaska Governor Sarah Palin lost her libel suit against the New York Times today when a jury rejected her claim that the newspaper maliciously damaged her reputation by erroneously linking her campaign rhetoric to a mass shooting. A judge had already declared that if the jury sided with Palin, he would have set aside his verdict on the grounds that she had not proved the paper acted maliciously, something required in libel suits involving public figures. Palin, a one-time Republican vice presidential nominee, sued the newspaper in 2017, claiming it had damaged her career as a political commentator and consultant, with an editorial about gun control published after a man opened fire on a congressional baseball team practice in Washington. Congressman Steve Scalise, a Louisiana Republican, was wounded in the shooting committed by a man with a history of anti-Republican Party activity. In the editorial, the Times blamed overheated political rhetoric. It likened the shooting to a 2011 massacre in Arizona that left six dead and former U.S. Congresswoman Gabby Giffords, a Democrat, severely wounded, and said Palin's political action committee had contributed to an atmosphere of violence at the time by circulating a map of electoral districts that put Giffords and 19 other Democrats under stylized crosshairs. In a corrections shortly after the editorial was published, the Times says that it had incorrectly stated that a link existed between political rhetoric and the 2011 shooting, and it had incorrectly described the map. A tweet read, "We got an important fact wrong." At the trial, Palin cast herself as a victim of biased journalism by left-leaning elitist media institution, eager to embarrass a pro-gun rights politician. You're listening to the Evening News on KPFA in Berkeley, KPFK in Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno online at kpfa.org. This is an hour-long newscast, and it airs each night at 6 o'clock with a half-hour edition on the weekends. I'm Mark Miracle. San Francisco District Attorney Chesa Boudin has alleged that the San Francisco Police Department Crime Lab has entered DNA from sexual assault victims' rape kits into databases without their consent and has used it to identify crime suspects. Boudin says the practice raises all sorts of ethical issues around crime victims' privacy rights. Max Pringle reports.
Boudin told a press conference Tuesday that his office became aware of the practice last week after a woman's DNA from a rape exam given years ago was used to link her to a recent property crime. Boudin says the practice violates trust between the community and the police.
Victims want, in many cases, nothing more than to go to a safe space, to shower, to clean themselves. It takes courage. It takes persistence to go to a hospital instead, to preserve evidence that can be used by my office to hold the person that harms you accountable.
Boudin said he's dropping charges against the woman whose DNA was used without her knowledge. He said that after an invasive examination, that is almost like a second violation, sexual assault victims are then given a consent form to sign.
They're given a long form. And on that form, on page 2 of that form, there's a patient consent section, and it's fine print. You can see how little it is. It's not designed to be easily read or understood by someone who's just been traumatized.
Kelly Lou Dinsmore is director of the Office of Sexual Harassment and Assault Response and Prevention, or SHARP. She said policies like these can alienate sexual assault victims from trusting authorities, which in turn makes prosecuting sexual assault crimes more difficult.
Survivors need absolute support and encouragement when getting a rape kit done, not the fear of future criminalization. Survivors need systems that center their healing after violence.
San Francisco Police Chief Bill Scott says his office is investigating the claim. He said if it's found to be true that the crime lab is using rape kit DNA to prosecute unrelated crimes, then he'll put a stop to the practice. For KPFA News, I'm Max Pringle.
The first witnesses for the prosecution began giving testimony today in the federal hate crimes trial of three white men convicted of murdering black jogger Ahmaud Arbery. In her opening statement yesterday, the prosecutor said all three had referred to black people using the N-word, and Travis McMichael, who fired the fatal shot, had also called black people animals, criminals, monkeys, and subhuman savages. Arbery's mother, Wanda Cooper Jones, said she was bracing herself for what she knew would be difficult testimony to listen to in the Georgia trial.
A whole lot of hard evidence is going to come into play, so I got to be prepared for that each and every day. But I'm grateful that we're here, that we made it this far, and I think that we'll get a good victory as well.
In their opening statements, defense attorneys called their clients' use of racist slurs offensive and indefensible, but they insisted that their deadly pursuit of Arbery was motivated by an earnest, although erroneous, suspicion that the 25-year-old black man had committed crimes and not motivated by racial hostility. Today, the last day to vote in San Francisco or to turn in the ballot for the San Francisco Assembly seat left vacant when David Chu became San Francisco City Attorney. San Francisco Board of Supervisor member Matt Haney and former Supervisor David Campos are the top contenders for Chu's former seat. Also in the race, Thea Selby, a transit advocate and trustee for the City College of San Francisco, and Bilal Mahmoud, an entrepreneur and philanthropist. No candidate receives a majority. There'll be a runoff in April. That person will then have to run again in the statewide June primary and then again in the November General Assembly to keep the seat for another 2-year term, meaning residents of the district could vote on the race up to four separate times this year. San Francisco voters also today deciding whether to recall three school board members after a year of controversy that captured national attention. For many parents, the recall's a referendum on how the city's school board managed the pandemic. Critics call the recall effort a waste of time, a waste of money, as the district faces a $125 million budget deficit. They've also pointed to the hundreds of thousands of dollars given to the recall campaign by a billionaire venture capitalist. Polls in San Francisco open tonight until 8 p.m. As a case about Florida election law changes that went into effect in 2021 is being heard in federal court, Republican state lawmakers are advancing even more voting restrictions. Tramell Gomes reports.
Florida Republicans are proposing yet another sweeping change to state election laws. The new bill would establish an Office of Election Crimes and Security, a slimmed-down version of Governor Ron DeSantis' elections police proposal. GOP Senator Travis Hudson of Palm Coast says it's meant to safeguard elections. But Mark Early, the supervisor of elections for Leon County, says it also adds further restrictions to voting by mail that could cause more confusion and problems.
We're very concerned as supervisors of elections that the requirement for these identification numbers on the vote-by-mail certificates is going to disenfranchise voters, complicate the process, and make it much more difficult for us to get our vote-by-mail ballots tabulated by election night.
The bill also would require voters to write identification numbers on mail-in ballots and create a new envelope, which Democrats say raises new barriers. Election supervisors say they were not consulted on the proposed changes, but Early says they're now vigorously trying to provide input. Election supervisors would have to update their voter lists more frequently under the bill, which also would increase the penalty for so-called ballot harvesting to a felony. But there was unified consensus that Florida's last elections went smoothly, even in public statements by Governor Ron DeSantis and Florida's elections chief, Laura Lee. Early says in his 36 years working on elections, Florida's was already operating at its best prior to the changes in 2021.
We're more than adequate and very, very good and well-designed to ensure the security and the trust of elections. Some of these other laws that have been coming forth since then, frankly, are playing on people's fears, and it's regrettable in many ways.
Groups including the League of Women Voters are already waiting on a federal judge to determine whether the last election's overhaul, Senate Bill 90, unfairly discriminates against minorities, older voters, and people with disabilities, in part through long lines at the polls, as alleged in the lawsuit. This is Tramell Gomes for Florida News Connection.
Texas has begun early voting in its primary elections under contentious new election rules aimed at making it harder to cast a ballot and easier for Republicans to maintain their hold on the state's congressional delegation and its state legislature. New York Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez in Texas to rally support for a progressive primary challenger to Democratic incumbent Congressman Henry Cuellar, though, says ultimately Democrats will flip the state Republican.
Texas turning blue is inevitable. Inevitable. It will happen. The only question is when, Texas? The only question is when.
Meanwhile, election officials in Houston say voters are confused about the new restrictive election rules adopted by the Republican-controlled legislature. Houston officials say that 40% of the first mail-in ballots that came in were sent back for not including required new information. By almost any measure, Utah's 2020 elections were among the most successful in state history, with record turnout and no evidence of voting irregularities. So why are some members of the Utah legislature wanting to make registering voters a crime? Mark Richardson has that story.
At least one group, the Rural Utah Project, says it's because its members did too good a job of getting Utahns to the polls. House Bill 371, filed last week by GOP Representative Phil Lyman of Blanding, also seeks to end mail-in ballots and drop-off collection boxes. Rural Utah Project Director T.J. Ellerbeck says the laws aim straight at political organizers.
As far as registering people to vote, this bill would make that impossible legally, because this bill also makes it illegal for an organization like ours or any random person on the street to register someone else to vote.
The Rural Utah Project has registered more than 5,600 new voters, many in tribal areas and in San Juan County, which coincidentally is in Lyman's district. When asked about his bill, Lyman told Capitol reporters that it wasn't about fighting voter fraud, but to restore election integrity. The measure drew immediate opposition from Lieutenant Governor Deidre Henderson, who said it has no basis in reality. In 2018, two of the three San Juan County Commission seats were won by members of the Navajo Nation. Ellerbeck says if HB 371 becomes law, almost everything that makes Utah elections work well would be tossed out.
We're an all-vote-by-mail state. In 2020, 94% of Utahns voted by mail, and this would eliminate that. It would probably cause our elections to triple in cost and just generally be pretty catastrophic for voter turnout.
The Rural Utah Project is part of a coalition of organizers, including the ACLU of Utah, Utah Disability Law Center, Utah Muslim Civic League, and the League of Women Voters of Utah. Ellerbeck says the group was formed to protect their hard-fought electoral gains.
Our vote-by-mail system in Utah works, and that's because we know county clerks across the state have figured out a way to implement it cheaply and safely. And there's no reason to change that system because it is working and it is already secure.
I'm Mark Richardson for Utah News Connection.
Voters are going to the polls in local elections in three states in India. The elections are seen as a referendum on Hindu nationalist Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Ishan Garg has the story.
Analysts say the second phase of the election is crucial for regional parties who are hoping to secure the votes of minorities and lower income groups. Two smaller states, the coastal state of Goa and the Himalayan state of Uttarakhand, will also vote today. If BJP loses the three states, analysts say it could make it difficult for Prime Minister Narendra Modi to secure a third term in 2024. While economic issues such as jobs and inflation top the agenda for many voters, polarization along religious lines is also expected to play a large role. Ruling BJP's ethno-nationalistic agenda appeals to many, but rival parties hope to win by promising social security. Ishan Garg, New Delhi.
The United States formally has requested the arrest and extradition of former Honduran President Juan Orlando Hernandez less than 3 weeks after he left office. It follows years of speculation about alleged links to drug traffickers. Honduran security forces surrounded Hernandez's neighborhood, and the Supreme Court of Justice scheduled an urgent meeting to select a judge to handle the extradition request. The National Congress vice president said Hernandez had to turn himself in or he'd be arrested. You're listening to the evening news on KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online, kpfa.org.
This is Kat Brooks. I'm an actor, activist, and freedom fighter.
And I'm Brian Edwards Tiekert. I mostly do journalism, which kind of sounds boring now.
And together, we host Upfront, KPFA's local two-hour morning magazine.
We bring you breaking news, debates, deep dives.
Reporting on City Hall and the State House.
Housing and transportation.
Prisons and police.
And everything big that happened while you were sleeping.
And it means the two of us get to hang out with you at 7 a.m. right after Democracy Now! On Upfront.
Questions about Donald Trump's business practices are piling up. Whether the former president is forced to answer any of them could be decided in a matter of days. New York's attorney general will go to court on Thursday seeking to enforce a subpoena for Trump's testimony in a civil investigation, she says, has uncovered evidence that his company used fraudulent or misleading valuations of golf clubs, skyscrapers, and other properties to get loans and tax benefits. The hearing before a state judge in Manhattan is the next step in a legal battle that's been unfolding in court papers over the last few weeks, including the revelation yesterday that Trump's longtime accounting firm recently dumped him after warning that financial statements it prepared could not be trusted. Trump's lawyers had argued that those financial statements were truthful and that attempts to pick them apart over any minor mistakes or omissions were politically motivated. Reporter Mike Clifford has more.
Former President Donald Trump's longtime accounting firm informed the Trump Organization last week that it could no longer rely on nearly 10 years' worth of financial statements and that they could no longer be their accountants, citing a conflict of interest. Quoting here, we've come to that conclusion based in part upon the filings made by the New York Attorney General, our own investigation, and information received from internal and external sources. That was in a letter from Mazars to the Trump Organization chief legal officer, advising them to no longer rely on financial statements from 2011 to 2020. Mazars also advised the Trump Organization to inform any recipient of the statements, such as lenders or insurers, to not rely on those statements.
Reporter Mike Clifford. Republicans on the Senate Banking Committee today boycotted a vote on President Biden's five nominees to the Federal Reserve. The boycott indefinitely delays the confirmation of Chair Jerome Powell to a second four-year term. Democrats control the committee, but because no Republican attended the session, votes could not take place under the Senate's rules. The boycott stemmed from Republican opposition to Sarah Bloom Raskin, a former Fed governor and deputy Treasury secretary under President Obama, whom Biden picked to be the Fed's top banking regulator. Ranking Committee Republican Senator Pat Toomey of Pennsylvania argued that Raskin had provided insufficient answers about her work as a board member for a tech firm. Toomey and other Republicans have asserted that Raskin inappropriately used her connections to the Fed to benefit the company. Committee Republicans have also objected to Raskin's past statements on climate change, in which she urged the Federal Reserve to consider risks to the financial system from weather disasters and other impacts of rising world temperatures in its bank oversight. Republicans argue she may discourage banks from lending to fossil fuel companies. Britain's Prince Andrew has agreed to settle a lawsuit filed by Virginia Giuffre, who said she was sexually trafficked to the British royal by the financier Jeffrey Epstein when she was 17 years old. Giuffre's attorney said in a filing in Manhattan federal court that lawyers on both sides were informing the judge they had reached a settlement in principle. The deal calls for the prince to make a substantial donation to Giuffre's charity, while saying he never meant to malign her character. Giuffre's attorney informed the judge presiding over the case in New York that a settlement in principle has been reached. Lawyers on both sides will request a dismissal of the lawsuit within a month. Sarah Walton reports from New York.
A statement from Prince Andrew's legal team says they'll file for dismissal once Virginia Giuffre has received the settlement, which isn't disclosed but is described as a substantial amount. Ms. Giuffre was suing the prince, claiming that she was forced to have sex with him when she was a teenager, during a period when the prince was friends with New York financier Jeffrey Epstein, who died while awaiting trial for sex trafficking charges in 2019. Prince Andrew had strongly denied the allegations against him. The statement says the settlement will be paid to Ms. Giuffre's charity in support of victims' rights. It goes on to say the prince never intended to malign her character and that he will fight against the evils of sex trafficking. I'm Sarah Walton in New York.
The family of a cinematographer shot and killed on the set of the film Rust sued actor Alex Baldwin and the movie's producers today, alleging their callous disregard in the face of safety complaints that led directly to her death. Attorneys for the husband and 9-year-old son of Helena Hutchins said that Baldwin refused training for the type of cross-draw he was performing when he fired the shot that killed her. Baldwin's attorney responded that any claim the actor was reckless is entirely false. The suit, filed in New Mexico's Santa Fe County in the name of Matthew and Andrews Hutchins, shows a text message exchange between a camera operator and a producer, in which a complaint over gun safety was met with what the suit called callous sarcasm. The operator, Lane Looper, texted unit production manager Catherine Walters saying, "We've now had three accidental discharges. This is super unsafe." Walters responds, "Accidental discharge on the firearm? Awesome. Sounds good." At least four other lawsuits have been filed over the shooting. This is the first directly tied to one of the two people shot. Nina Maria Potts reports.
Alec Baldwin is accused of firing the bullet that killed Helena Hutchins on the set of the movie Rust in New Mexico, a bullet that also struck director Joel Souza. The prop gun was not supposed to have been loaded with live rounds. Helena Hutchins' husband, Matthew, has filed the suit on behalf of himself and his son, Andros, alleging that Alec Baldwin recklessly shot and killed his wife. The actor has insisted he hadn't even pulled the trigger and that he had no idea there were real bullets in the gun.
I'm Nina Maria Potts in Washington.
Investigators say a small-town police officer in South Carolina has been charged for shooting and killing an unarmed man who led her on a high-speed chase and then tried to run from his wrecked car. Hemingway Police Officer Cassandra Dollard faces one count of voluntary manslaughter in the shooting after she chased the driver 8 miles outside the limits of the town. Officer Dollard tried to pull over Robert Jr. Langley for running a stop sign, and it turned into a chase where Langley was driving more than 100 miles an hour. That's according to an arrest warrant from the State Law Enforcement Division. Agents say Langley crashed his car in a ditch and was trying to get out the passenger door when he was shot in the chest. Officer Dollard told investigators she feared for her life. She faces 2 to 30 years in prison if convicted. Following an investigative journalism expose, the Bureau of Indian Affairs has announced it's reforming its tribal jail system. Madeline Beck of the Mountain West News Bureau reports.
A Mountain West News Bureau and NPR investigation found a pattern of neglect and misconduct that led to more than a dozen inmate deaths. The BIA then hired a consultant to review the deaths, and now it's proposing changes it wants to make. That includes more training on how to perform in-custody death investigations. Assistant Secretary of the Interior Brian Newland put it this way.
The report lays out recommendations for the department, informed by an assessment of the thoroughness and effectiveness of in-custody death investigations.
However, the BIA's proposed changes don't include harsher penalties for misconduct by jail employees or more medical personnel in tribal jails. Newland also said he was looking into whether the agency's contract with Daryl Cruzan to review the deaths followed laws and regulations. Some congressmen have been critical of the contract because, as an interior official, Cruzan oversaw tribal corrections during 7 of the deaths. After leaving the agency, he became a consultant and his firm won the contract to review the jail deaths. For the Mountain West News Bureau, I'm Madeline Beck.
American criminal justice reform advocates are looking at a youth justice reform program in Northern Ireland as an example of successful restorative justice. Jonah Chester has the story.
Northern Ireland's Youth Justice Agency places an emphasis on early diversion, community involvement, and restorative justice. Kelvin Doherty with the agency says the goal is to keep kids out of police custody and prevent them from racking up a criminal record.
Let's address these concerns and these issues before the police are called and before they get into a court setting.
Doherty says the restorative justice process can take one of several paths, including a simple apology, community service, or mental health treatment. According to data from the Youth Justice Agency, more than 97% of victims say they're satisfied with the restorative justice process. The Youth Justice Agency was established in 2002 and was born out of the Good Friday Agreement. Doherty explains the program was part of a multi-pronged effort to modernize Northern Ireland's justice system.
And the modernization process said, well, for a new justice system in Northern Ireland, it has to be not just about children and reducing reoffending, but it also has to be for victims and for communities as well.
From April 2020 to April 2021, Northern Ireland's Justice Department saw a nearly 17% decline in cases where kids came into contact with the criminal justice system. Doherty says early diversion and support programs, typically used when the child is between 10 and 12 years old, can help prevent kids from coming into contact with the criminal justice system down the line.
Problems can be resolved in the child's life before they get worse. And it has a better outcome for agencies and service providers because it often involves less effort and more success the earlier you are intervening or diverting children within a justice system.
According to the Children's Defense Fund, nearly 2,000 children are arrested in America every day. While the organization notes the overall number of kids in the juvenile justice system was halved from 2007 to 2020, severe racial disparities persist, as children of color are nearly two times more likely to be arrested than white children. For the Illinois News Connection, I'm Jonah Chester.
California's Secretary of State says reparations for African Americans should be limited to the descendants of slaves. Shirley Weber is the daughter of sharecroppers who authored legislation creating the first in the nation task force in California to study and recommend reparations. She said slavery drilled fear into families, stunting their ability to strive beyond survival. She said Barack Obama likely never would have dreamed of being president had he descended from slaves. She said black immigrants have known racism, but they always had a country to return to if they wanted. The state task force has until 2023 to complete its work. Longtime Pacifica Radio KPFK programmer Fernando Velasquez died over the weekend after suffering a brain aneurysm. He was 73 years old. Velasco began his career at KPFK more than 40 years ago as a member of Colectivo Latino Americano, KPFK's first Spanish language programming block. He directed programming in the news department and produced KPFK's Spanish language news broadcast, Informativo Pacifica. Velasquez trained countless volunteers during the decades at KPFK. Details of his funeral and memorial not yet determined. Fernando Velasquez, veteran journalist at KPFK Radio in Los Angeles, dead at the age of 73. A new study of the mega drought affecting California and the rest of the western United States says the region is the driest it's been in at least 1,200 years. The study in the journal Nature Climate Change calculated that 42% of the mega drought can be attributed to human-caused climate change. Study lead author Park Williams is a climate hydrologist at UCLA. Williams said that climate change is changing the baseline conditions toward gradually drier conditions in the West, and that means the worst-case scenario keeps getting worse. Williams added that this is in line with what people were thinking of in the 1900s as a worst-case scenario, but he said we need to be even preparing for conditions in the future that are far worse than this. Williams studied soil moisture levels in the West, including California, Wyoming, Utah, Nevada, Arizona, most of Oregon and Idaho, much of New Mexico, western Colorado, northern Mexico, and the southwest corners of Montana and Texas. He said the current mega drought is now 5% drier than the old record from the 1500s. Sunny tomorrow in the San Francisco Bay Area with highs in the mid-60s around the bay. Further inland, highs in the upper 60s. Highs in the mid-60s in the central San Joaquin Valley tomorrow under sunny skies. And ditto for the Los Angeles area. Tomorrow should be sunny with highs in the mid-60s. That's it for the news tonight. For this Tuesday, February 15th, thanks for joining us. I'm Mark Miracle. Good evening.
Tune in Tuesday nights starting at 7 p.m. with La Raza Chronicles, a weekly Latinx affairs magazine program with local and international focus, highlighting the social, political, and cultural events affecting the Latinx community. After that, it's international jazz, Latin jazz, and more on bebop, kubop, and the musical truth with Avacha. At 10 p.m., it's the Reggae Express with Spliff Skankin and Tony Moses. That's Tuesday nights on 94.1 FM KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.